Buenos días. Quiero dar la bienvenida hoy de nuevo a esta escuela Ana Heringer. Acabamos de tenerla hace muy pocos meses, pero la hemos tenido en un evento muy cerrado, en un congreso de arquitectura tradicional que se realizó en la escuela. Volver a ver a Ana entre nosotros es una gran alegría. Hoy viene de la mano de una institución muy importante, de la Fundación ICO. La Fundación ICO ha asumido algo que es muy querido para mí, que me he pasado toda mi vida comisariando arquitectura, y ha asumido ese empeño en Madrid. Ha asumido el hacer las grandes exposiciones de arquitectura. Los arquitectos tendemos, las arquitectas tendemos a pensar que la arquitectura es propiedad nuestra, y no es cierto. La arquitectura es lo que cobija todas las actividades humanas. Y la arquitectura debe de ser entendida no solamente por nosotros, no debemos estar metidos en una torre de marfil pensando que dominamos un lenguaje y que por tanto somos los que vamos a decir a la gente cómo vive, sino que tenemos que oír a esa sociedad. Pero esa sociedad también tiene que enterarse de lo que la arquitectura es y de lo que es en muchas partes del mundo. ICO está haciendo esa misión. ICO se está ocupando de que la gente de nuestra ciudad se entere de cómo es la arquitectura y de que no es solamente un dominio estrecho y reservado para una profesión, sino que es una profesión que hace realidad los sueños de la sociedad. Pero hay que oír también a esa sociedad y para eso esa sociedad tiene que estar informada. La conferencia de hoy entra dentro de este ciclo. Luis, como siempre, muchísimas gracias. Luis Fernández Galiano siempre ha ayudado en esta escuela a través de una agenda maravillosa de Luis y a través de Arquitectura Viva. Y hoy tenemos el honor de tener a Lucinio, tener al director de la Fundación ICO con nosotros, a quien les daré la palabra en un momento. Ana, gracias por estar, gracias por ser tú, gracias por hacer que la arquitectura sea sostenible, gracias por demostrar el empoderamiento de las mujeres y el empoderamiento de las mujeres en todos los terrenos y en todos los territorios. Somos una escuela de mujeres, somos una escuela que somos muchas más mujeres que hombres en estos momentos. Y eso se tiene que ver también en la gente que nosotros invitamos, en la gente que viene aquí. Gracias por hacernos entender que de la arquitectura tradicional puede salir la arquitectura más bella contemporánea y que tenemos que aprender del pasado y de cuál es el contexto de las arquitecturas, que la arquitectura es fruto de unas circunstancias históricas concretas y que eso tenemos que hacerlo con mucha seriedad, con mucha tranquilidad, con mucho respeto a los demás y a las tradiciones. Y que de eso es de lo que vamos a aprender y estas generaciones van a aprender directamente. Thanks for being here with us, Ana. Lucinio, si no te importa, me gustaría darte la bienvenida a la escuela.
Muchas gracias. Yo voy a hacer solo publicidad corta. Nosotros tenemos, como se ha dicho, el Museo ICO. Estamos dedicados específicamente a la arquitectura desde 2012, de manera que cumplimos nuestro 10º aniversario. Y en este caso concreto, una de las cosas que se ha dicho aquí es importante que sepáis, ¿no? Primero, que es vuestra casa y que ojalá hubiera 4, 5, 6 o 7. A mí me preguntan: ¿te preocupa que ahora pueda haber otros museos dedicados a la arquitectura? No, ojalá hubiera 8 en Madrid porque habría capacidad. Nosotros tenemos solo 2 exposiciones anuales de arquitectura y una de fotografía dedicada a la arquitectura o al territorio, y habría espacio para muchísimo más. Y simplemente para que sepáis el papel del arquitecto: el arquitecto en un momento determinado se veía como una especie de figura inasequible, o sea, inasible, inentendible, ¿no? Y nosotros, para que sepáis, en el Museo ICO estamos dedicados a la arquitectura. Un 45% de nuestros visitantes tienen que ver con la arquitectura. El 55% restante no tiene ninguna relación con la arquitectura. De manera que la gente empieza a interesarse por la arquitectura, el urbanismo, cómo vivimos. Es una cuestión importante. Y nada más, simplemente animaros a venir aquí. Estamos en la calle Zorrilla, justo detrás del Congreso de los Diputados. Posiblemente dentro de 2 años nos moveremos al Paseo del Prado para estar en la milla de los museos. Y desde luego os esperamos aquí, os esperamos allí. Y en este caso concreto es un verdadero honor haber contado con la exposición de Anna Heringer. No os voy a hacer el spoiler de las cosas porque luego, si no lo habéis visto antes, es muy impactante la primera vez que ella habla. Y voy a dejar que Luis Fernández Galeano, que ha sido lógicamente, en este caso concreto, es el comisario y ha hecho otras exposiciones también con nosotros y con Arquitectura Viva, sea el que explique un poco cómo está organizada la exposición. Y después vamos a dar la palabra a Anna Heringer. Simplemente una cosa que me ha impresionado como no arquitecto, que se puede aplicar a todos los ámbitos de la vida. Se habla mucho de sostenibilidad, se habla de durabilidad y tal, pero son cuestiones abstractas, ¿no? Y hay un momento en el que eso hay que llevarlo a la práctica. Y me encanta Anna Heringer otra vez. Ojalá tuviéramos muchas Anna Heringers porque ella es capaz de llevarlo a la práctica. Y tiene una norma, una regla, que se puede aplicar a cualquier cosa, a cualquier ámbito, pero que se aplica a la arquitectura. Una norma para ver cómo se aterrizan estos principios generales. Que es que cuando yo diseño un edificio, cuando estoy haciendo un edificio, planteando un edificio, me pregunto, ¿cómo sería el mundo si todo el mundo hiciera lo mismo que yo? Es decir, si yo utilizo un bote de pintura plástica, en un momento parece que no es relevante, pero si todo el mundo, si 8.000 millones de personas lo hicieran, de manera que eso me parece una norma de comportamiento clarísima, sencilla, y ojalá lo utilizáramos en todos los ámbitos. Y sin nada más, animaos a venir al museo, traer vuestros amigos, es gratis, o sea, esa es una de las cosas. Y bueno, la exposición estará hasta el 8 de mayo y le voy a pedir a Luis Fernández Galeano que os explique un poco cómo está estructurado antes de darle la palabra a Anna Heringer, que de verdad es verdaderamente impactante. Muchísimas gracias.
Quiero darle también las gracias a la Fundación y a Luis. Porque han contado con la escuela en el montaje de esta exposición. Hay un panel que el Centro de Investigación de Arquitectura Tradicional ha realizado. Jesús San Vicente y Antonio Vela han dirigido a un grupo de nuestros estudiantes para hacer una de las piezas de la exposición. Lo hicimos también con Francis Queré y nos encanta participar también en esto. Luis, esta es tu casa siempre, con lo cual...
Bueno, en mi casa todavía, sí, aunque ya estoy... jubilado, catedrático emérito, pero ya fuera de la vida cotidiana de la escuela. Muchas gracias, Manolo, siempre acogiéndonos. Gracias, digo Manolo, director. Y gracias, Lucinio, porque el ICO lleve ya 10 años dedicado a promover la arquitectura, ¿no? Es un privilegio. Y es verdad, una cosa importante que has dicho, es un poco también una exposición de la escuela, ¿eh? Porque Suso y todos sus amigos... que aquí está sentado en primera fila, han hecho una de las piezas que además ha sido elegida por todos los visitantes, ayer, por ejemplo, por Norman Foster y por la vicepresidenta del gobierno, ¿sabes? Nadia Calviño, para retratarse. O sea, que han elegido retratarse con la pieza de la escuela de fondo, ¿no? Una pieza diseñada por Ana, pero ejecutada por estudiantes de esta escuela en Segovia, ¿no? La verdad, para mí es estupendo volver a la escuela una vez más, estar con una muy querida amiga, una gran arquitecta y una gran artista. Lo vais a ver en la exposición. No voy a explicar cómo es, tenéis que descubrirla y sorprenderos de ella. Pero sí deciros que es una gran arquitecta, una gran artista y al mismo tiempo una persona con esa conciencia social y ecológica genuina, que es tan rara hoy en día, porque la verdad es que el usar, digamos, los temas ecológicos para disfrazar otro tipo de iniciativas, ¿verdad? Hoy todo el mundo habla de sostenibilidad, de verde, de participación, pero mucha gente habla, pero pocos lo llevan a término con la consistencia y con la belleza que lo hace Ana. Y solamente, pues nada, saludarla aquí en esta, que es también su casa, y disfrutar de la conferencia. Y eso sí, reitero la cuña comercial que ha hecho Lucinio, por favor, ir al Museo ICO, como digo, es gratuito y podréis fascinaros con la arquitectura y con el proyecto vital de Anna Heringer. Gracias. Gracias, Ana.
En esta casa no tenemos que darte la palabra porque siempre la tienes. Estás invitada a estar aquí siempre que quieras y a contar con todas nosotras, con todos nosotros.
Thank you so much. I'm happy to be back. It starts feeling like home. Yes, to me, architecture is a tool to improve lives. Oh, I think I have a double. Is this it? Is it? The resources that you have readily available, given by nature, finding the resources within you, also around you, in the network, and trying to make the best out of it, without depending on external factors. And this is what I tried to do, or to transmit into architecture then 7 years later, with the Matrix tool, that was my diploma project. So in terms of materials, I didn't have to look far, they were right under my feet, the dirt, the soil, the earth, and the bamboo that was all going around. And in terms of energy sources, my favorite source of energy is all of us people. When we think of energy sources, we think of oil, we think of sun, wind, and so on, but all of us, we are also a source of energy, and we are a creative energy source. And we are a growing source. We have almost 8 billion people, and we have a very human notion and need that we want to be needed, that we want to do something useful. And I think, you know, that's a wonderful thing with architecture is that we can include a lot of people, especially if we're built with materials that are inclusive and accessible, then we can include a lot of people. We can create a lot of work. And if we don't use the source of energy, we also create a social problem. So for me, people are really a key element in all of my projects. And this is the school after 6 months of construction. It was my diploma project, but for the realization, I had a partner. I said, "Well, Scott," because when I came out of university, I had to admit I had no idea how to build. But what I want to say is, you know, we are taking it for granted that when you come out of university, you're working in someone's office. But you could also start your own way. You know, you don't have to step in the holes of the previous generation. You know, you can also find your own passion. Experiment is a good time, a moment in life also where you don't have to pay it for a family, you don't have to pay back, you know, like mortgage on a house or whatever. So it's a moment where you're free and, you know, test out yourself. And I think that if I was lucky to do that, it was really wonderful, and I just can recommend it. Yeah, that is the classroom tradition to sit on the ground, and we kept this tradition in the younger classes. And through the photo, you come into the case area, and that was for me, you know, why did I design case? Well, the client wanted to have round classrooms, you know, everything organic. But then I thought, you know, a round classroom forces everyone to be part of the group, but sometimes, you know, you want to retreat, you want to have, you want to step back and be on your own also, and then you're also more social when you have this possibility to retreat. And then I thought, okay, but briefly, most of the time was to design in a way that it enables joyful learning and that you do well as a child. So I channeled my inner child and, you know, the spaces that I loved when I was a child, and I think probably a lot of can connect with that too, you know, building some small case with branches or also textiles, you know, and the best moment is always when you're when you are protected, like being in the crown of a tree, you're protected from use, but you can hear everything. You have the full overview of what's going on. So that's a little bit of a similar situation in this case. You sit here, but you still are connected. You know what's going on. So I was trying to integrate this kind of atmosphere also in that school building. And then the opposite is kind of the treehouse. The children all find that the names at the doors, and they rightfully did so because they also had buildings in the school. That was for me really an essential element of this process. You know, my colleague was not so happy to have the children on the side. He said, we have failed enough. Do they really have to come and say, yes, I want to have the future users involved? And we had especially a team of teachers, of Montessori teachers with us from Austria, who were just there to integrate the children. And you cannot do this with every material, but with mud, you know, you need only your hands. You don't have any tools that could harm you. It's not toxic. It's a wonderful feeling you have to have the hands in the dirt, in the clay, and that makes it so inclusive. We also have people with disabilities working with us, of course, men and women, and that is one of the elements why I'm also so happy to work with Earth, because it can include a lot of people. And you probably can imagine how it feels as a small boy or a small girl, or also an illiterate day laborer who never had the chance to be at school, you know, standing in front of that building after 6 months of construction, and you know, you did this. You just using your muscles, the dirt underneath your feet, and the team around, and it's such a boost of confidence in your own potential, in the team, in the community, and also in the local materials, which is really important because those materials, especially earth, has a very bad image of being extremely vulnerable, which is not true. If you follow certain rules, meaning a good foundation, good boots, and a good house, a good roof, then those kind of walls can stand for hundreds of years. We also have this tradition in Europe. Alhambra, for example, is partially also built in red earth. So they can stand for a long time, but there is this, you know, notion attached of fear, of decay, of vulnerability. But for me, it is a huge potential, because it's the only material you can take from the ground. You can recycle as often as you want by just adding water. You know, normally when you recycle things and materials, you lose a lot of quality, and you have to put in a lot of energy. You don't have to do this here. It remains the same kind of quality, you even get a bit better. And if you don't need it, you just give it back to the ground it came from and plant a garden on top. So that makes it, for me, the champion for sustainable construction. And in terms of economics, you know, for me, it's never the question just low cost, low cost. So for me, the main question is pro bono, who gets the profit? And for me, you know, we deal with big budgets. I mean, also public money. We have a responsibility. I mean, when we end up all our building budgets in the end of our career and life, you know, we come up to millions as architects usually. So I want to be able to tell myself, you know, this money really ended up people who really needed it, craftspeople, and not just the big industry. So I was also, of course, living in that village where, you know, in the end of the day, the workers would get the money, and I could directly see how this building budget was spent. So they would just, you know, invest in the vegetables of the neighbors or get a new sari blouse at the tailor. So the building budget not just had a building as a result, but it also was a catalyst for local development, and that was the part that made me most happy. Local materials, local energy sources, especially people, plus global knowledge, that is the approach that I'm having in all of the projects, no matter in what context. I think, you know, knowledge, information is something that should not be limited to a space, that should be accessible everywhere. And now with our digital means and technologies, we can do this. But it should all be always, you know, make sense to the local context, always be applied to them. Here you see my two passions, architecture and textiles, meanwhile. We all shape constantly spaces, not just as architects and urbanists and so on, but also as consumers. And this is a big part of the show at ECO. You know, when you come in and you enter, you see a lot of textiles. You don't see architecture at the first glance. But this is architecture too, because every shirt that we are wearing is having a space, as a result, also somewhere else. And most of the times, you know, our shirts and whatever clothes, you know, we are wearing are made in Bangladesh and are having such spaces, you know, as a result. And I felt, you know, as an architect or as someone who lived in Bangladesh, you know, coming and going, but over more than 25 years, I couldn't look away from the topic of the textile sector. You know, it really shook me. And I wanted to do something, but I felt with architects, I'm at the limit with my tools, so I had to change the tools. And I was trying to design, together with the textile designer, Veronica Lang, to design a product that can be produced completely in a decentralized way so that the workers that usually live in conditions like this don't have to go and live in the previous life conditions. So as a woman, you know, in the villages, you have a household that you can build up with your own means, with your family, with your own hands, without paying much. The whole village is a fantastic playground. Elderly people are integrated. You have your cows, your goats. You have a little house garden that provides food. The only problem is, you know, that you don't have enough land resources anymore because of the overpopulation, so you have to have a second economic leg. And that, for many people in Bangladesh, is the textile sector, and that's why they're going to live in those places. When we think of made in Bangladesh, we think of the cheaply made, you know, shirts and whatever. But actually, Bangladesh has a fantastic textile culture. And same as in architecture, where we look what are the local resources, what are the local potentials to do this also not in textiles. The woman usually gets one sari per year, a man a skirt, and when they're worn out, they're not torn away. They're kept and then put into layers, and with a lot of hand stitches, they're fabricated into blankets, and then people sleep on top of those blankets because it's a fine, soft surface. And then the layers start to peel off, and the whole family history reappears then again. And before they fall into pieces, you know, they come now to our textile workshop in the village, and then products are being produced for our market here in Europe. And it's, you know, usually we produce the clothes in a very cheap way there, exploit the resources there, then we wear it a couple of times, 4 or 5 times, then we send it. You know, so we put it in the dustbin, and then we would put it, ship it to Ghana, for example, where again this first local market. And instead of doing this, you know, we said, okay, we're sending the old clothes. This time we sent the old clothes from Bangladesh to Europe with a high price, also to say, you know, we don't need to always create some new resources when we have something good. We can also take existing things, add another layer of creativity, another layer of craftsmanship, and have something that is bespoken, that is unique, and that has a history, and that we can, you know, is not following any fashion purpose, but stands on its own and can be worn for a long time. We also started to document our own project on this blanket for the maple school, and this is the documentary of the village, of Rutherford. And what you see here for me is really a beautiful example of sustainability. These blue dots, they are the ponds for the excavation, so that's where the people dig out the soil for building the houses. The dark green spots are the bamboo cultivations where they harvest the bamboo also for construction, and then all around, of course, the food cultivation. And this closed circle of material use and agriculture and architecture and everything, that is for me really very symbolic and a strong wisdom about it when it comes to sustainable living. In the beginning, we started, you know, not having a particular space for the women to work because we thought it's, you know, it's perfect. They just take the piece of fabric, they take it home, work from home whenever they feel that it's a good moment. But then we understood that they were all coming and gathering because they lost, you know, the chat while they were working, sharing their experience, the stories, their joys. So we understood we need a place for them. This is why we designed the Anomaloy building, which is also a center for people with disabilities. And unlike the previous buildings that are built in Bangladesh that are very straight in the rectangular box, which was, I think, that time important to show that you can work in a very precise way, even with just dirt and just the local materials. But in this case, I wanted to break out of the mold to show, you know, that it's beautiful that we have a diversity as human beings, that we are not all following the same pattern, and that this is a beauty that we have to celebrate, and that it is a joyful thing. So this building is literally dancing, and when you approach it, the first thing what you notice is a ramp that kind of winds up all around the building. And people immediately ask, you know, why do you need a ramp? It's the only ramp that they know in this area. And then you're directly at the core of the discussion, why inclusiveness is important. And this is also what I love about architecture, that it makes so easily things visible that otherwise are not a topic. And especially, you know, the people with disabilities, they're usually very often hidden away, because there is a certain notion of guilt related to it. You know, why do you have a child with disability? Did you do anything wrong? Was it bad karma? You know, is it a punishment of Allah, whatever? So this is something, you know, they are unfortunately very often hidden. And now they have a place where a lot of people just come to see, you know, this building that is something special, and they feel, you know, a sense of dignity and pride also, which is really, really important, that, you know, they felt welcome. And also the therapy itself, you know, you see the case are different, like in the medical school, you can really crawl into it from the ground, and you have to move your body in a more difficult way through this case. So it coordinates, you know, it triggers the coordination of the muscles and so on. So it's part of the therapy itself. But it's a joyful part. It's not just, you know, having a tool where you step up, you step down, you do this movement, but it's something, you know, rewarding when you move yourself through this space. And that was the space underneath the ramp. That's the ramp, how it winds up all in modern bamboo. It's really like a very soft sliding up. I have to say I'm a very impatient person. I usually take 2 steps at a time. I want to, you know, be fast. That's where I have to. But I so much enjoyed it. You know, I even made a shortcut, you know, in the building, because I thought it's really annoying if you have to go all the way around. But I so much enjoyed it, you know, this flow and this softness with the material. It's like really gliding up, and then you have all these different views and canopies. It's really a beautiful atmosphere. The funny thing is that the animals like it so much. You know, snakes, dogs, I mean, that there was not in the other buildings, but this one, I don't know why, but they really enjoyed lighting up there. So we have to do a little barrier for them. And this is the workspace of the textiles of the room. 7 billion, it should be already there times 8 billion, but when I wrote this, we were about 7 billion. Luciana already mentioned it. This is something I always have in my mind whenever I'm designing. And designing is constant decision making. And the world is not changing with one big decision. The world is changing with the everyday small decision. Am I taking this paint, this glue, this foam, this, you know, material? Do I take mud? Do I take concrete? Do I take, you know, styrofoam as an insulation material or straw? You know, these are the things. Maybe, you know, it's just one family house. Maybe it's just 1 liter of paint. But if you multiply it by every one of us, you know, by 8 billion people, if everyone was doing that, it would be really have a huge impact. And just because I have the means, just because I have the power to go in the shop and buy the thing, I'm not allowed to do this, because we have one planet with limited resources, and we have to care for this planet, and we have to care for each other. So, you know, having this in mind always, you know, that the way I'm deciding should be really not contributing to social injustice, but to justice, and keeping also our planet healthy. How to put this into the European context? Well, together with Martin Rauch, I had the commission to build in a company headquarter, a space that is somehow related to the African context, also partially Bangladesh, because the sponsored project there. And we wanted to take one of the most simplest methods of building, literally taking the wet soil and shaping it with your own hands. We wanted to take this one into the European context, into the regulation system, and into the economic context. And we shaped, like, literally a vessel, a two-story vessel out of this material. You see it here, it's an interior space. So we could do all sorts of shapes. It's a very archaic, introverted space. The company itself, you know, it's a headquarters, so you have lots of people, there are lots of communication, you even can't close your own office door, there's constant exchange. And at some point, you know, with all the emails, phone calls and so on, you want to have a place, you know, where you just can retreat, where you can be on your own, to yourself again. So this is a moment where you can take a breath, you know, and some work and find your inner strength again. So we kept it really monolithic. And then there were also there was also there because there was a previous contract from a different designer before, so we had these buildings already existing. So we thought, okay, we're going to hang also structure from the top, a wooden structure that is also kind of with an upholstery from a fair trade. So this is the space. Yeah, and it also, you know, blooms in the light, so it illuminates the entire space there. So it's a meeting room, but also a huge lamp in a way. This is the space in the ground of the monolith where you can sit in a much smaller group. It also has a super sound system. You know, you have a big, you have, it looks low tech, but it's high tech. You have a wall, you have a heating source in the tank. Then the outside could be cooled, the floor can be cooled. Then, you know, you have all the lightning, electricity, sound system, everything is integrated, and it's so easy to do this in the mod, you know, you just insert it in the clay. And then we had a problem with the heating, you know, that was a water pipe that was plastic. You know, it was very clear where the problem is because it was wet. We just took out the mod, fixed the pipes again, put the mod back, it looked as before. You know, if this was done kind of in a poorly something, material or cement, that would have been really difficult to repair, but it is not. So this is how the structure of the Zeppelin was made. And it's a non-violent search in Aleppo, because it's in India, and then of course all our own test sites in Bangladesh. This is how it looks like. And then we did also, Jesus, you might notice, where are you? Then we also did, you know, some of the other hangout spaces. We also put in always a mud wall, and this is for me an example how you can insert this kind of materials also in existing structures, because in Europe we do have a lot of existing structures, not always about building something new. So, you know, imagine a classroom, you know, and or a kindergarten where the kids come together, and we just had it, you know, with students from, what university was it? It was this one, yeah. Students from EDSAM. So coming together, you know, and doing this wall. And it's not just, you know, that you do something, but it also bonds you together. It's joyful. And you have your hands in mud. It's also sort of therapeutic in a way. At least that's how I feel when I'm working with mud, you know. And it's acoustically really good. Instead of having a stupid acoustic panel, just put in this. And it's even balancing the indoor humidity perfectly. So it would really kind of contribute to the indoor climate, and plus has this effect of participation and joy, and of course beauty. So how is it the difference, you know, working in a European context and in the context of Bangladesh, Ghana, and so on? It is so much more expensive to build in a sustainable way in Europe, and that for me is really tragic, because, you know, why should you be financially punished just because you're building sustainable? It should be the other way around. You know, it definitely should be the other way around. And it's not, you know, that the soil is given for free. And it's literally, you know, the craftsmanship that is inside. And we have high taxes on human energy, on craftsmanship, but we have very low taxes on CO2, for example. So I think there's an imbalance. And we have to work on our economic system. I mean, systems can change. They're not a natural force. They're man-made, so we can change it, you know, and we definitely need truthful prices on materials. You know, it can't be that materials that are harming the environment also cheap, you know, they must be taxed higher. Another project in the Alpine context is the bird space. So we, together with a group of four, Anka Dürr, Sabrina Sommer, and Martin Rauch, and we got together and designed a prototype for a space for giving birth. And we have spaces for almost everything. But when it comes to give birth, we either have the chance, you know, to do it, the choice to do it at home, or we go into a hospital. And then imagine you're a baby in your mother's womb. It's all cozy, dark, tight, and then you come out and you have this super bright light. It's such a shock. And the first moment in everyone's life has an imprint in everyone's biography. So we wanted to, you know, get a different way. Also for the women, you know, how is it? You know, you have to open up. It's all about the process of giving birth. It's about opening up. But then you're surrounded with materials that you don't want to touch even, you know. You don't want to look look at it because they are ugly, they are super high tannins, you don't want to touch them. So we thought, you know, earth is actually a wonderful material because you actually want to touch it. And it, you feel embraced and it's an element. I mean, and it, you know, you become a part of earth when you're getting born. So we built a structure out of mud bricks. And it was also, we didn't find any companies who wanted to sponsor this project, but we found more than 400 women who sponsored for it and paid for it, and said it's important to us, this topic. So, and they also had buildings, so it was a participatory process, we prefabricated it, and then brought it to the site, and of course, this shape, you know, would result in a climate like in Vorarlberg or in West Austria, so we put a lot of shingles directly in the mud to cover the, and to protect the earth. And the shingles are a traditional, very traditional element there, but we used it in a bit different way, you know, with different, you know, in the beginning it was really the craftsmen were like, you know, because they're super craftsmen in that region, they're used to work very precise, and, you know, and this chaos in the beginning was, you know, well, you actually want to have us do unprecise work, and it was funny for them, that there was one guy in the team who was always teased by the others because he couldn't do the straight line. So he was suddenly the hero, you know, because he could do it best. Yeah, this is the ground floor plan, so this is actually this little cup, and here we tested it, you know, we put the ground floor plan on the floor rotation, and Kabir is not just an architect, but also a midwife, so she tested different birthing positions, and this is, these are the tools that are needed for giving birth, so I actually did a mistake, I gave birth in, or tried to give birth in a horizontal way, in a bed in a hospital, it didn't work out well, it ended with a cesarean, you actually have to work with the vertical. You know, you have to work with gravity. So I wish I had done this project a bit earlier. So it's really this kind of sensual, archaic atmosphere in this space. And because it's a prototype, it's used a lot also with discussions and so on. So there is a place for discussing in front of it, and with a fireplace, and also a garden with medical plants, for, especially for the community. It's located in a beautiful area, but at best, and normally it would be, of course, good to have it close to hospital. Another project in different context in China, about bamboo, it was an international bamboo biennale where 12 architects got invited, Senko Puma, Simon Welles, and so on. And I was commissioned to make two hospitals. And the idea was to have a core made out of stones made out of French earth, which are all in the village, still, you know, use techniques, and that houses all the facilities, and attached to it, you know, you have, like, Chinese lampshades, you have, like, concourse, where the boys and girls can sleep in. It was, for me, like, mandala drawing, you know, and I'm usually, I don't like very symmetric things, I really like it usually wild and chaotic and organic. And I really had to focus and to concentrate because I felt, you know, this is the right thing in that context. So, but, in, you know, after doing one or two or three floor plans, it became really like mandala. It became almost like a meditation thing. It really started. Yeah, for me it was a big question, you know, how do I insulate these huge vessels, you know? And then I observed the people there, and first I thought it was a strange fashion. Actually, it looks like a blanket that my grandmother had, you know, this kind of thing, but just tailored around the body, and then I said, actually, this insulation, you know, it's not, you know, they live in cold spaces in that village, and then they insulate the body, and then they heat themselves or walk up with a pot of soup or a tea, and I thought, okay, if you get faster, maybe we can go a bit more extreme also, you know, to test out. So the idea was, you know, you have a good oven in the ground floor that also heats up the hot water for the showers above. And then, you know, in the evening when it gets cold, there's a gong and you get your hot water bag, you take it into your little concourse, you put it into your sleeping bag, you have the heating source on your body, you have the insulation wrapped around yourself, you're sleeping in a cold room, which is actually healthy. And then in summer, you just open the concourse, you have just a mosquito net that protects you. That was the concept that did not work out of time. Didn't really understand, you know, this was working, you know, but that, I would have loved to test it out. So this was the drawing for the concourse in summer that we can just open it. Okay. Ah, this is the flyover, so okay. was really fascinating to see how well they were doing, you know, this sound structures. And normally, you know, the guy who built this thing, he was also building the expo in Shanghai, and so normally he cannot hire people from the village or from the direct around. He always had to fly in his experts. But this time with the rent earth, you know, and bamboo, he could actually hire people from the village, and it made him also happy. So here you see the core. And this is a picture, you know, that's the reality, you know. And between 2011 and 2013, China has consumed more cement than the United States in the past century, past 100 years. But this is not only China. This is happening, this trend is happening all over the world. You know, we abandon all these traditional vernacular building materials, we forget them and move into structures like this. We invest a lot of CO2 to erect the structures, and then we have to add another CO2 level because we all need air conditions, you know, because in this climate and everything, you can't live just in concrete buildings. So you have to add, like, the electricity also, you know, you see, like, all the dimples having the air conditions on top. So this is a tendency and a trend that we cannot just continue because this is definitely wrecking our planet, and we definitely need alternatives. And to me, building a natural material such as timber, bamboo, earth is really effective. And it helps mitigating two of our main problems and challenges that we have currently, which is the climate change and also the social injustice. Because as I said before, you know, working with natural materials usually requires a lot of craftsmanship, requires a lot of work. It's not, you know, something you can patent easily, so you cannot monopolize it. So this is another reason why, you know, it's important to build with natural resources, not just because of ecological reasons, but also because of social justice. You might wonder, you know, is this possible in a dense urban space? Of course it is. This was just 500 years ago. If we were able to do this that long ago, why shouldn't we be able now to do it with all the technologies, with all the knowledge that we have in our hands? So all we need is, you know, to kind of cancel the barriers that we have in our mind. It's just in our mind that we think it's not possible these days anymore. This is a project in Ghana. I was just there 2 weeks ago. And this is the master plan. It's an educational center for Don Bosco, for the Salesians. And this was actually the master plan that I got from Ghana. But of course, this has nothing to do with the Ghanaian culture. This is, of course, something that has been imposed for decades of missionary times, colonialism, development aid, and so on and so on, that, you know, schools have to look that way, and a campus is looking that way. And when you look all around, the villages, they look like this. They have this extremely vibrant mix of round huts, of squared ones, courtyards, and so on. It's beautiful. And you know, all the organizations that are coming in with money, with power, with education, built in a different way, and that leaves an enormous imprint and influence, of course, on this culture. So I literally took this mud and deformed it, you know, the master plan, and tried to bring in these rice, these beautiful rice that are there still in the villages. So you see a little village, this is where the teachers would live, and then the students also, and this is more the classroom spaces. And this is how, you know, it was the end. So I'm always doing a clay storming. I'm always designing on clay models. Then, you know, I take one of these and then make it in a larger scale. This is the school of construction that we're starting soon now. This is what you see the building, how it looks now. So, you know, you go from the master plan, then you take it in a little bit bigger scale, and then you go on a site and then you go in one-to-one scale. Just the same material, just in a bigger scale. This is Katharina Kohlhofer, who is managing the site for a long time there. We're, by the way, only a female team. We have Stefania and Anna also here. And this is how the school is growing up. You know, it's just the same as in the model. And this was 2 weeks ago. You know, the engineer would always say, hey, don't chop the building like a coconut. You're not killing it here. We had to get rid of the first plaster that was not working. It was for me very important to hire also women. You know, it was something, you know, the man there didn't want to do, to have the women there. Said, I want to have a part of the building, but it also ends up with the women. And then the women were coming late to work because they had to carry the water before, and they had to cook for the husband. And then they were saying, you know, you cannot you cannot hire women, they're always late, they're not reliable. So, no, it's not their fault. You know, they are very reliable, they're taking on so many other tasks. And then they say, you know, you cannot give them the same amount of money. I said, of course I can. You know, that's why it's also important, you know, to really fight for those issues as well on the site. It's not just the architecture. And then, in the Saturday, they would also take the family with them. And the kids so much enjoyed, you know, having their hands involved. And they were singing, you know, that was not just for the video, that was just happening there. And this is how we would make the mark. It looks actually like a very joyous site. The site was joyous, but it was really difficult for me. It was quite a fight to explain, you know, why it is necessary suddenly to build with earth, you know, and not with concrete. But the clients would have preferred, you know, because they're used to do it since a long time. But, you know, for the women, I asked them, how would it be if this was built in concrete? They said, well, we would have no roof, you know. And then also the interior climate, you would need a ventilation. You would need an air conditioner. You would spend a lot of money in electricity. This is all not needed. And besides that, they also see, you know, this is our culture. This is beautiful. It's more beautiful than some stereotype kind of concrete blocks that have in the end no soul. And you see, you know, how much caress is going into this voice. You know, it's literally caressing the voice. And this is love put in a building and a structure. And I think you really feel it. Another project where I tried also, it was again with Martin Ralph, where we tried to bring in, you know, the things that we learned from the Global South into the European context. You know, the story is not that you go somewhere, you know, as a European and go in a developing country and you do something good there. Now, of course, we have to learn a lot of things here in Europe too. And one of the things we have to learn is, you know, that the process is just as important as the outcome. Your sentence, Louis. Yeah, we learn to design the architecture, the building, but we don't learn to design the process. But the process has so much social power in it. You know, in the past, we came together as a community. We built up a church, a temple, a mosque, a school, a city hall. We have each other building the houses. And this is bonding. This is fostering communities. And we are not lacking as a society. We are not lacking of materiality. We are not lacking of good relationships. So this is why we said we are not coming with a finished object, but we are coming with the tools. And then we get together as a community. We take the dirt, we take the soil, and build the altar out of the local earth. Because in the end, earth is more precious than gold, because gold cannot feed us, gold cannot house us, but the earth can. So they would all come together, the choir, the council. It was hard work, but it was good, you know, because when someone says, oh, this one is exhausted, I'm going to help. You know, you help each other, and then there's this non-verbal communication on the side. You work hand in hand, and this is really bonding. And then we had, you know, the concept was in the beginning, you know, to insert in these different layers different elements of the history of Rome. So this was actually the 1,000-year-old cathedral or anniversary of this cathedral. So they wanted to bring the history of this place, and Rome is a very specific place in German history. It was an emperor's cathedral. So they brought in, you know, elements from the Roman Empire, from archaeological excavations and so on, and then other cathedrals also sent forth, you know, to kind of join forces. But then, you know, after 2-3 days, people started to bring their own personal items, you know, a necklace, a postcard, a diary, song book, and so on, the best wine they were proud of in the region. And, you know, the kids also came, they mixed them up, they were standing with the heat, they decided to put pink glitter in it. The priest was scared that the altar would pink, you know, with glitter and pink in the end, he didn't want it to be But the kids were super excited. They came every day to check, you know, how high the altar was going. And then the moment comes, you know, when homework is released, and then you see finally the product of, you know, day's work and the week's work, and it's just a part of it. No, and you know, that's the most exciting thing when you finally see the result, but already the process was so good and not so strong. So, you know, in the end, it was, you know, we couldn't let go. We were like standing there and having this thing, and you know, you see how many different people are coming together here, and that's like all part of it, very much a part of it. And this is how it looks in the end. And for me, this is really symbolic with all the gold in the background. You know, we are not lacking of materiality, but of meaning and big relationships. Form follows what? Form follows function. I think it's so much outdated. We have so much more complex issues to tackle. We cannot do that just with a reduction on pure function. We have plenty of functional buildings around. We have plenty of also good-looking buildings around. But I think we really need meaningful buildings and really beautiful buildings. And of course, it's a big question, what is beauty? And I can tell it only for myself, you know, for me, beauty is a formal expression of love. And if you build things, or if you do things out of love towards the other, towards the planet, you naturally also do it sustainably. So for me, the hope is that we use architecture and form, you know, to follow that. Yes, please. I want my team here. You know, this is all, you know, there is many people involved in this project. And I'm very glad they are with me here. Victoria and Anna. Lucia, thank you. There's actually one more in Austria or Germany. Thank you. If you have any questions, just shoot away.
Hola, Ana. Quería preguntarte si la cimentación de los edificios de barro también es de barro o tiene que ser de hormigón. La de la cimentación.
The foundation is the only part where it makes sense, you know, to use a durable material, like stone, like brick, like even like concrete. I'm not saying that concrete is a bad material, but the overuse, you know, the way we use it is really bad. So I think, you know, foundation, okay, but then, you know, for the walls we should go on with something else. But there's a rule, you know, good food, meaning a material that can, you know, that stops the water from rising into the mud walls. This is essential. And then a good roof, and then the walls are standing for a very long time.
Y otra, es que, bueno, me encanta tu trabajo, perdón, tenía que haber empezado por ahí. Siento la dificultad de utilizar estos materiales en el día a día porque siempre hay problemas. Por ejemplo, hay que dar un acabado al suelo, alguna cera. ¿Qué tipo de acabado das para hacer impermeable?
Those materials at the Eco Show, we have displayed it, but they have a brand earth floor and a wax on top, or also like clay casuline. Casuline is a glue that is produced from milk and a bit of lime, and that also makes wonderful floors.
How were projects like the Meti School in Bangladesh financed?
That was a very particular one. I literally had to go from door to door to sing. It was the Carol Singers campaign. I don't know if you have this in Spain. Spain, but we have to produce in Germany like off between the 1st and the 6th of January. Some teams are going from door to door and singing Collect Donations. So this is what I did with my friends.
Okay, thank you.
No, luckily I don't have to sing for my mom anymore. But I'm still responsible for it. I mean, not entirely, but most of the time I have to. And, you know, it is a lot of time input that goes into these things, but, you know, so many architects invest a lot of time in doing competitions, and, you know, and you're taking it for granted that you do 6 competitions, you know, for just for the waste bin, and you win maybe one of them. So instead of investing a lot of time in competitions, you know, I prefer investing time in really, you know, doing the project from the concept, the crowdfunding and everything, you know, from scratch. Because then I know, you know, that, you know, the philosophy is correct and I don't have to compromise on that thing.
Sí, yo quería decir, bueno, primero agradecer de nuevo a Ana que nos haya dado la oportunidad de poder hacer el panel con nuestros estudiantes. Y una cosa que yo quería decir es que una cosa que nos hemos dado cuenta cuando trabajamos con las manos es que trabajar con las manos es muy sanador, es muy terapéutico, es algo realmente que produce muchísimo placer. Entonces, también frente a la pregunta de María, ¿qué se puede hacer con estos materiales aquí? Pues yo creo que lo que también podemos aprender es que proyectar con las manos y proyectar, hacer formas con tus manos moviendo el barro, también es una herramienta de proyecto muy bonita. Y que yo creo que también aquí en la escuela acostumbramos a la gente a que primero hay que pensar con la cabeza y después la cabeza transmite tus pensamientos a tus dedos y a tu teclado. Y yo creo que a veces hay que invertir ese proceso y hacer que tus manos, como dice Richard Sennett en su libro del artesano, hace también que tus manos tengan su propio cerebro y hace que tus manos informen también a tu cabeza. Entonces yo creo que también el trabajo manual es una cosa que hay que experimentar mucho también en la asignatura de proyectos, cómo hacer que trabajando el barro se producen formas diferentes y se cambia tu vocabulario proyectual también. Y yo creo que eso es algo que nos enseña mucho el tipo de proyectos y la manera de trabajar de Ana Heringer.
I do the homework, you know, studying the resources that are there. But then I'm trying to make myself really free. And I have this block of earth that I know, okay, this is the room program, you know, it's a certain amount of volume. And then I'm really, you know, I'm really in a very intuitive way starting to reshape the things. And it's like, you know, you get immediately an impulse in your gut feeling, you know, it's how high you can go, you know, for example. And, you know, you maybe think, you know, it makes sense to make a tower. You build the tower, oops, you get a big amount of too much. And you cut it, no, it could be a bit higher. So you know, and at one point, you know, it's really that the hands are taking over. I have the feeling, you know, I get the impulses right out of the gut feeling into my hands. And my main task is, you know, not to get my intellect to interfere with the thing. And that's really, for me, always surprising, you know, when I see the final result. Because it's not that I'm having a certain style, it looks always like different, and it is, I think, very much influenced by the genius locus, but also, you know, what intuitively comes. And sometimes, you know, there are pictures coming in from a basket that I've seen in a completely different connection, but it makes sense, you know, because it's possible to do it with the local resources. So it's like a little bit like cooking, and you cannot cook without with an empty fridge or with an empty basket. So you have to fill your intuition, you know, you have to collect the patterns, the pictures, you know, the good buildings that you experience. And luckily, traveling is a good way, you know, to fill this basket. And then, you know, when it comes to intuition, then suddenly these things are coming up, you know, these pictures. And it, you know, that just kind of floats all into this mud. I think it's good to divide your life kind of in three aspects. Like one part, you know, yes, go for a bread job because you need to pay your bills, you know. But don't give it more importance than one third. And one third, do your real passionate, your heart job, you know, the thing that you really want to do. And then the third is, you know, is simplify your life, you know. Go to a happy frugality where you don't need many things, you know, that gives you a lot of freedom, you know. I'm still buying second-hand clothes, you know. First, because I don't want to support, you know, the way of production or a way of self-made or fair trade, or you know, the food, whatever. You know, do a lot of things that you actually need yourself, and that even can trigger, you know, new projects. Because you know, if I wasn't sensitive about the textile things and didn't learn tailoring myself, I would not have gone with the textile things. So you know, it's also a source of energy. So I think with this combination of these three factors, you can actually really follow your heart and don't have to press yourself into the mainstream thing that you don't want to do.
The work you showed us, it's like perfect for a rural context. I was wondering how we can adapt your techniques, your way of thinking to work in an urban context. I mean, which material could you prefer, or which techniques?
Yeah, for example, now I'm building a large structure in Germany, so of course there I cannot replace the water bottle, so of course you need more machinery. So you could go for prefabrication. There are, you know, machines that can rent earthworks, they're cut into huge blocks, you know, they're dried just naturally without any additional energy input, and then when they're dried out, they come into the site, and you can just pile it up to multi-story buildings. And this was happening, for example, if they have the Dönerland building in the Ricola Health Center in Switzerland, another project in Natura in Germany. So these are the technologies that I think that are making it really possible and feasible to use these materials also in urban contexts. And we are constantly digging out this material, you know, every underground parking, metro line, foundation, you know, because land is becoming more precious, we have to go and put more infrastructure underground. And all of this is a fantastic building resource, you know. Instead of paying for dumping this material, we should put it in local factories, you know, and get the building components like this red prefabricated rent earthwork, the mud blocks, red clay bricks out of it. You know, Paris is now having such a factory, for example. So this is possible.
Did you have any inner battle or personal battle when you were studying the career?
If I had any personal?
Battle. With a fight, a personal fight.
With myself?
Yes, or with the way that... or with the way the career of other people make architect.
Doing this kind of architecture that you're taught to do. And then, you know, for me, the lucky thing was, you know, I always had the passion for development work, for the environment, for social justice, and I had the passion for designing. And I didn't know how to combine these things. And literally, for me, the missing link and the glue to combine these things was the mod, because it has all these environmental aspects and the social aspects, and on top of it was really beautiful. So that was, I think, you know, every one of us is coming with certain special talents, you know, on this planet. And I think life is opening the doors that you can really develop and live this talent. It would absolutely not make sense that we get talent and not the chance and the possibility to use those talents. So I think we just have to, the open doors are open, and then, you know, if life is giving you the chance, then go for it. Thank you.